righty, welcome to Vanguard USA's meet and greet via Zoom here with our ambassador, Jose Rodriguez, better known as No Way Jose, No Way Jose Photography Online. Good to see you, man.
It's good to see you. How's it going?
Doing great. Jose is going to talk to us today about composition. I'm going to tell some stories, show off some work, and talk about how he finds the spot and having an eye for it in general. But before we get into all that, I'm going to let Jose give a little introduction to himself and to maybe tell us about how you got into photography in the first place.
Of course. Thank you for having me. I'm super excited to be here to do this. So, all right. So long story short-ish is I was born and raised in San Juan, Puerto Rico. And then when I was just to fast forward, I was getting my degree in graphic designing. There was a small elective around my second year. There was elective of Photoshop, just to, you know, how graphic designers use Photoshop. And then there was a 3-day course there about, like, okay, Photoshop is also for photographers. So here's a camera. It was like an old Nikon. So you could learn how photographers also use Photoshop throughout this graphic designing course that I was taking.
Right.
And those three days kind of changed my life, how they say. Those 3 days were like, okay, hold on. One, I think I'm pretty good at this. And two, I had a lot of fun doing that. Mm-hmm. So then while I was in college doing graphic designing, I've been cheating on graphics with photography. And I would always like kind of just like use my friend's cameras or the college cameras. And then until I bought my first camera, which was like a Sony A250. They don't make it anymore. It's just a right. cheap camera. I think it was like the megapixels were like 8. And I was like, this is great. Like, and I started taking a lot of, I guess you could call it fashion photography. But it was just all my friends, to be honest, it was just my friends. We would just have a couple beers and take pictures like kind of in the street or in the mm-hmm. alleyways, just kind of trying to find cool little spots, like half fashion and half urban.
Right.
And I kept doing that. Until I graduated. I even graduated graphic designing and I got my degree in that, but I kept pursuing photography. And then I got my first job as a fashion photographer in Puerto Rico, where I eventually got fired from that job because I was really good at, you know, I could take the pictures of the runway shows, but I was also attracted. That was like at that time, at that age, I was trying to like kind of, I don't know, adventure out in the world of photography, mm-hmm. practice club photography, studio photography, car photography. And during one of those fashion shows, Dave Navarro, a rock star, whatever it was the after party. So I ditched my job as a photographer to take pictures of Dave Navarro.
Hey,
so when so when the client asked for those fashion photos, I was like, sorry. And that was it for that. But
but I have Dave here.
Yeah, no, but I took pictures of Dave, and then unfortunately, you know, Dave hasn't got to see that photo yet because it was before, like, I mean, I'm just to say now, I'm like, well, I'm 35 years old, right? So mm-hmm. so that was before, that was only when I think Facebook just existed. That was it at that time. So so it was like I couldn't just, you know, tag Dave Navarro at that time, so I should now.
Yeah.
But just to like kind of fast forward it, I started adventuring more out in the world of photography when it comes to portrait. So fashion led me to concert photography, event photography, and then event photography led me to portraiture and just kind of just continuing like that studio photography. And I was able to like kind of learn my craft in a sense of like, what is it that I like? And then I realized that I liked editing, and that's where the graphic comes in. Mm-hmm. But just to like kind of keep fast forwarding it, I really wanted to, we all know the Afghan girl photo.
Mm-hmm.
Most of us do. Steve McCurry shot that mm-hmm. photo.
Yeah.
So that image stuck with me in a very young age. And I was like, man, I wanted to see who this photographer was. And then he introduced me to conflict photography.
Right.
War photography, kind of just more of a journalist, like documenting stuff, real world, you know, like, excuse my language, but real world shit happening in the world. Okay, this is the stuff that I wanted to do. And so I didn't know how to do it. I didn't know where to go. I didn't know if I just had to book a ticket. So I just realized, okay, I need to figure out how to do it. So I discovered that the military had a job like that. Not a lot of people know it. I don't know how I discovered it. It's called, it's called a COM cam for short, but combat photographer.
Right.
And I'm like, that had my name on it. So I signed up behind my parents' back and then I just kind of like rocket ship to that. And then turns out I'm pretty good at it. And I loved like kind of my experience behind it. Mm-hmm. I got to do it. I know that we don't need to talk up too much about military because it's about composition, but I did get to deploy twice and take a lot of images of mission scenarios like that. But that just that experience, believe it or not, just kind of helped me realize how to succeed in the world of photography. Mm-hmm. So once I was stationed in Fort Bragg, but once I was sent to Hawaii, which was a blessing, me being from Puerto Rico, I'm a tropical creature.
Right.
So Hawaii was like the perfect place for me to learn. The one thing I'd never done was landscape photography. Mm-hmm. And believe it or not, landscape photography introduced me to Vanguard. And I'm like, okay, I could rock with their tripod because it's what I was looking for. The style of photography that I was doing, Vanguard was able to provide it with me, because mm-hmm. the other tripods or accessories I was using, I've always had to like manipulate it in a very in just different ways, still make it work. Mm-hmm. But Vanguard made it easy for me to learn what I was doing there in Hawaii. So landscape awesome. Photography was introduced to me in Hawaii, seascape. And then when I moved to Maryland is when I I got noticed, or I got discovered, or I got a lot of attention with my photography. And that's where like kind of like that's what I call like my military experience, my fashion photography in Puerto Rico experience, all that stuff culminated into like, okay, what have I learned? What can I do? Why am I frustrated? What is everything? Just kind of like in a movie, the climactic moment is when I decided to do like a challenge.
Right.
I'm like, let me figure this out. Let me see, because I was very frustrated as a photographer because I felt like I was good, but I wasn't noticed enough. And then I had so many excuses, and I hated myself for all these excuses that I had. So I decided to like stop with the excuses and kind of just have a little bit more discipline and commitment to it and make mm-hmm. sure I did a photo a day for 30 days in October. And then that's when like the snowball effect started happening. And I said, you know what, let me keep it going for a whole year and let me do one photo a week for 52 weeks. Mm-hmm. And then, you know what, let me document and record the behind the scenes. And I started posting it everywhere, you know, that consistency that they say. And yeah. then that's how No Way Jose Photography was like kind of born. Mm-hmm. And then that's as short as I could give it as my photography bio.
I'm still just like, I'm still mentally dwelling on the fact that you're so dedicated to photography. You're like, I'm going to join the army because it's going to give me a cool shot at something. Like I guess I always assume like somebody joins the military for you know, other reasons, I don't know, but it's like you're like, photography is going to take me to the army. That's pretty sweet. I love that.
It was a shortcut for me, honestly. Like yeah, I wanted to do what Steve McCurry was doing, but once I joined the military and I ended up like kind of continued to doing that, and then like it was going to take me to Hawaii. Mm-hmm. So I have nothing but good things to say about my military experience, you know, that's because awesome. Of photography.
That's awesome. So all these different types of photography, you mentioned you got into seascapes and landscapes. And where would you say you've settled in now for most of your work, type-wise?
Style? Today? So I consider myself, yes, you're right. I consider myself definitely, at first, people don't see this. When like other people talk about No Way Jose Photography, they'll probably talk about mostly the photo challenges and then the crazy shock factor fine art experimental photos that I was doing.
Those are fun too. Yeah.
Well, those were done on purpose. That's exactly like that. I wanted to capture people's attention, but with, you know, what was my inspiration for that was Dexter. I was watching Dexter at the time, the show, and how creepy and weird it is. So I was like, you know, let me do some creepy and weird photos. But though that's I think what like people recognize me for.
Right.
But at heart, I'm a seascape photographer. So I'll adventure rock climb or find like the perfect view for like rock sea, ocean waves. That's who I am. And then at second place, yes, experimental photographer, where I'll try to like, you know, capture the audience or the viewer's attention with like, you know, what the heck are they looking at type of thing. And then the third, I would say, is a combination between street photography or that uncontrolled action where you just go out there with a camera and try to create something.
Yeah. Does a lot of that come from your military, your combat photography kind of?
That's where it comes from mainly. Yeah. Because obviously I'll pull up some stuff, some military images that I could show you. There's situations in the military for sure. We've seen movies, right? So like military, they have a very strong personality. So imagine trying to tell like a Navy SEAL, for example, like, oh, when they're climbing something or in the middle of a mission or middle of an engagement, and you tell them, oh, can you just do that again? You blinked, you know, can you hold that pose? No, I've learned a lot from like, okay, this is uncontrolled. Let me try to like figure the formula out of how to be a successful photographer in this kind of environment.
Right. And that's an excellent point. I mean, you don't get a lot of do-overs when when they're working the way they work and doing their thing. I mean, I can't imagine, you know, if you did ask, like maybe some of the reactions you'd get.
You don't get any, I swear.
So, yeah. Or maybe some choice words, huh?
But, exactly.
Or maybe just a look, I think.
Yeah. And then again, I should probably apologize. I do try to control my language. So like, I'll do my best here.
Hey, we're adults. It's all right. We'll just put a little rating on our video.
Nice.
So kind of moving into, you know, the main topic what we're talking about today, which is composition and finding the spot. Let's maybe start talking about, you know, the landscape aspect, or I can let you kind of take it where you want. And you can, if you want to show some photos off, maybe if that helps, and you can talk about, you know, how you found this spot or just the composition itself. I guess if it's not a landscape photo, it might not be a spot as much as it is a setup, but you know, you can take us through whatever you want. It's your show, man.
Okay. No, definitely. Okay. I appreciate that. So basic composition to me, like here's the thing. We all know what the basic composition rules. I mean, if you're starting the world of photography, or if you're just starting, you're going to learn quickly about like the default stuff, like rule of thirds, leading lines, framing, all that stuff you could learn on your own. I'm not going to like take time right now to teach that. What I want to do is take this time to show you how I use that or what I look for, because the basic composition, like I mentioned, rule of thirds, leading lines, you have to obviously always do that. It has to be installed in your brain, but there's more to it. And then that's kind of like what I wanted to discuss with some images here. So what I have my notes here as well, just so I don't get lost. So
yeah, no worries.
So the composition. So these are like kind of composition, just to like kind of throw it out there. It's not only to be visually more pleasing, but it's I use it to control the viewer's eye,
right?
And then that's something that like I haven't heard people say, like composition is not just so okay, he's in the rule of thirds, but you could use a lot more. You could use the foreground and background to lead the viewer's eye to that rule of thirds.
Yeah,
that makes more of a powerful image. That's how I see it. Like right. I am in control of the viewer's eye. So when you look at my image, I'm giving you kind of like that composition experience, if that makes sense.
Yeah, absolutely.
So things that I kind of tell people to ask themselves, this is what I do. I always tell, when it comes to portraits and uncontrolled action and street photography, my rule of thumbs, as far as composition goes, it's two eyes and one ear. That's one thing. So I always make sure there's two eyes and one ear, unless you're purposely doing a profile shot.
Right. Okay.
And then when it comes to like landscapes and all of other photography, for me, it's also what is the center of interest? Like, I got to make sure that I know what it is, whether it's, and I'll show you some images here quickly. Mm-hmm. But what is the center of interest? What do I want the viewer to actually see at the end of his experience or her experience? And then what's really, really important to me is to eliminate distractions.
Mm-hmm.
Eliminate distractions. Like we've all seen like kind of like the pole popping out of like someone's head in the background.
Yeah. Yep.
Or that bright color in the back. You know, how do you eliminate distractions, you know, with the skills you've learned? That all to me is all about composition as well, because you're gonna have to like either move the angle, change the angle, or move like kind of the subject.
Right. Makes sense.
And then the last thing I always ask myself is, what is the strongest point of the image? You know, like, is it the subject? Is it the lighting? Is it the patterns? Is it the colors? You know, so those are the questions I ask myself when it comes to composition. So
cool.
Let me go ahead and look, pull something up here. All right. And here goes. Boom.
Got it.
Nice. Can you see the?
Yeah. I love this one. Sorry.
Right. All right, cool. All right, so let me just use this image for example, right? Mm-hmm. So always look at the background. You know, and then if the background is too distracting, ask yourself, how can I change it or how can I use it, right? So things that you could use is obviously depth of field or change the angle. That's mm-hmm. kind of where I left off. But don't be afraid also to get close to your subject, whether it's a person or in this case, like kind of a little toy car.
Right.
You know, that's... And then let me just kind of like take a moment to not talk about this image. And that's one of these things that I always like when people ask me, like, how do you take these images? And it's simply like, I think people just have to be, it's not easy, but you just have to be a little bit brave and get close. And then you don't join this, this world of photography and, you know, even videography to like kind of play it safe in a sense. Like we've all had like that rough moment where you either been rejected or don't take a mm-hmm. photo or you had a rough client. So we join the world of photography knowing that this may happen. So don't be afraid to get close. I know this photo isn't the best example because it's a toy car, but eventually I'll show you, especially with the military imagery, like you have to like zoom in and out with your feet and start like kind of building that I guess thick skin, I should say. Because
zoom in and out with your feet. I got to remember that.
Yeah. Zoom in and out with your feet is one of those things that I started doing, because especially if you claim to be like more of a prime lens shooter,
mm-hmm.
you have no choice but to zoom in and out with your feet, you know? Yeah. And then those are the ones that even like I was an instructor at one point in the military. So I always tell my students like you're gonna like what I was telling you, it's not always gonna be like, oh yeah, go ahead take a picture of me. I've had like kind of people like tell me like, hey, get that effing camera out of my face, you know.
Right.
But like, how do you deal with that situation? But like, it's one of those things that you gotta know it's gonna happen, mm-hmm. you know. It doesn't mean to quit, but I digress. I'm sorry.
That's all right.
So reasons I show you this image is because here's like kind of the things I was talking about, like just with rule of thirds, for example. I put the toy car. I put mm-hmm. the toy car right there in the rule of thirds, even though it's a vertical image right in that third area right there.
Right.
But how do I make a regular rule of thirds image stronger? And then that's what I ask myself, like, okay, boom, it's a cool photo. But what else can I do? And then I discovered this, and this is something that, I mean, I didn't discover it, but I discovered it like with experimenting myself. I'm like, you know what? I think it's a more powerful image if you use rule of thirds, but you the other third, mm-hmm. whether it's the foreground or the background, you know, let it add to the image.
Right.
So I decided to put my camera on a time lapse, like a 3-second photo. Every 3 seconds, it'll take a photo, and I would just walk with my thumb out, like if I was hitchhiking. And, you know, these are things that I learned slowly, like experimenting with composition. So that's one of the examples I'll show. I like to show a lot here.
And by the way, for people watching, Jose shares a lot of these behind the scenes, how he made the shot videos, which we'll probably talk about a little bit more in a little bit. But this one I know has one that I've seen.
No, this is definitely one thing that I could pull it up here and then we could screen share it here. But there's a behind the scenes, of course, of this image. And it's one of my favorite images. It's probably one of the images that I repost a little too much because I like going back to it.
It's fun.
So that's kind of how I use rule of thirds. Mm-hmm. That's kind of just to like finish rule of thirds. So rule of thirds is usually just to like to finish with that composition itself. I usually use rule of thirds a lot for travel, street photography, creative photography, like I just showed, and also for like kind of the uncontrolled military, kind of a lot of rule of thirds there. The one I was going to show you, which I'll just pull it up right now, actually, is this one right here. Boom.
Oh, yeah. Do you see that? Yeah.
All right. So just a story behind that one. This was me, you trying to use like a lot of compositional elements here, like I'm using lines, angle as a Dutch tilt, for example. And then also like the rule of thirds with the, this is a Navy SEAL. He's climbing up a boat. So think about it as like pirates and pirates trying to like kind of get on a ship to like kind of clear it, make sure it's not dangerous,
right?
Make sure it's safe. And then we leave, you know, but we have to like first like kind of climb onto it. This is the example that I think of where this man trying to climb the boat. I can't tell him to hold that position. I can't tell him to do it again. So you just have to like what I tell students and what I tell everyone, especially when it comes to uncontrolled street photography, you have to try to anticipate the shot.
Mm-hmm.
If a subject that you're shooting is going to take a left and then you anticipate that he's going to take a left, then you made it. But if he takes a right, you can't like stay on the, you can't get frustrated. You got to move on and try to fix it or try to do it again or try to go move on. Just keep doing something else. You know, yeah. So this is the example I use for like the rule of thirds and uncontrolled action.
How did you pick that angle right there? We're on the boat. Did you quickly make a decision like this is where I'm going to stand?
So we organize and we do a lot of training before the actual mission. So I was there's a total of four of us that were going to climb the boat, and I was third man. So two people will climb the boat and do security, and talk about anticipating the shot. I knew that the person behind me is going to climb and the two that were in front of me were going to set security. So as soon as I got on the boat, I turned around as quickly as I could. And I've already preset my camera to like, I knew it was going to be, I checked the weather. So I knew it was going to be sunny. So all I had to do was just put it in aperture priority because the shutter was going to already be up the roof because it was a sunny day.
Mm-hmm.
So I didn't worry about like kind of like the shutter speed. I just worried about the aperture. And then I just took this picture and burst and prayed for a good one. And then make sure. And I had the focus, like kind of I dialed the focus in that rule of third area.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, kind of those spray and pray type of thing.
Yep.
And I got the shot, you know, but that's but it's not about getting the shot. Like, as far as composition goes, like, to keep it in the topic, like, that's one of the things that people don't talk about much. Like, I could talk about rule of thirds all day, but people don't talk about waiting for the moment or anticipating the moment. That's how you get that composition. Like, there is, like, there is no, you could set up a composition for sure. And if you're doing studio or you're like kind of, you know, you're planning your shot, but for the street photographers out there, for the people who do all these uncontrolled actions and stuff like that, this is how I'm able to get that composition. You got to anticipate it and pre-plan it as best as you can.
Right.
So.
Awesome. Yeah. I find myself being one of those people, because I'm not a pro photographer and I haven't been in it as long as, you know, a lot of people have. And one of the things I find myself leaning on when it comes to getting composition is in post, you know, and it's like, so, you know, I get the, you know, the luxury of having a 50 megapixel plus camera, you know, you can, a lot of times I find myself, I'll just take the picture, man, and just get it done, you know, but then like I'll crop it so it's the composed how I want it to be, you know, and it feels like I'm cheating quite a bit. And I want to get better at having the good shot, the good spot in the composition before, you know, I snap the photo.
Yeah. No, and I get that 100%, you know, but I, you know, you got to consider that mostly as like a blessing, mm-hmm. because like, it's like back in the day, right? Like you got the shot and that's it. Mm-hmm. Like that's the shot. So yeah. I'm pretty happy that you could, you know, do as much as we can today at post, but I guess I mean, maybe it's like kind of when I started and like, I did start, you know, like I mentioned the digital era. Mm-hmm. Like in 2006 or whatever, 2007, either way though, like I do appreciate the process on location.
Mm-hmm.
Like I've never said in my life, oh, I'll fix it on post, because I know I can, mm-hmm. but that process to do it on location, like it's fun to me. Like it's like an achievement.
Yeah.
You know, so I know I could fix it. I have fixed a lot of things on post.
Sure.
but I do try my best to like kind of like that whole process on location. You'll see me like if you ever shoot with me, like I'll be dancing or acting a fool once I got the shot I wanted, like oh, like this is what I was like, that's happened, that but that happens on location.
Yeah,
you know,
it's exciting.
Yeah. All right, so again, I've been talking a little bit. It's weird because when I talk about composition, people are always expecting, like I said, rule of thirds, leading lines. But we all know that. I feel like we if you don't know, you will eventually know that. Everyone just says it. So the mm-hmm. things that people don't talk about composition are another example that people don't talk about composition is contrast.
Mm-hmm.
Like, and I'm not just talking about highlights and shadows. I'm talking also about colors and color theory and complementary colors, and maybe this is where my graphics comes in, but those are things that I noticed. Like mm-hmm. for example, this image right here is a perfect example for color contrast. Like we got the teals, the color of the wood, the red, and then the sky, you know, it's blue, it's red, the sun setting. Like those images, like we got to pay attention to color contrast and try to like kind of be there at the right time at the right moment.
Mm-hmm.
Like I use this image by for example because by the way, can you see it?
Yeah, I'm loving that. I haven't seen this one yet, so I'm like really like taking it apart here.
So this image is, it's like, and I'm gonna keep repeating this, composition is more than just rule of thirds, because composition is kind of like the things that you have to like pay attention to.
Mm-hmm.
And then that's what people don't talk about. They don't talk about things you got to pay attention. I was noticing the sky,
right,
and what was happening. And this image, you know, here goes a quick story about this image. This is, I could say that back in Nam, this is me in Vietnam. So nice. I was in Vietnam, and one of these, I was walking around with a friend, and he's not a photographer. He's just one of my friends, and I'm walking around with my camera and he's just following me around. We're just hanging out, having a good time. And I'm doing a little bit of street photography in Vietnam, and we meet, and then we go to the river, it's a big river. It's a big river. And then I started taking pictures of like kind of the river, slow shutter type of thing. Mm-hmm. And there's a bunch of boats around. And then one of the boat stops and pulls over, comes out, and they ask, like, hey, do you want to come in the boat, whatever? It's one of those things, like, I felt like it was like a touristy thing. Like, right. Hey, come to the boat for money. You know, and then yeah, you'll enjoy it, whatever. Just give me money and I'll give you a boat ride. And I was rejecting him, like, nah, man, I'm just here walking around. I didn't want any tourist thingy. I just wanted to walk around and take pictures. Right. I'm hanging out with my friend. And then my friend talked to the guy. His name, he called himself Captain Dan. And he talked to that guy. And it was, he had a very strong accent, right? And he just kept saying Captain Dan. And then AJ, which was the friend I was with, kept asking how much? And he said free. And I didn't believe him. Cause I've traveled long enough to know that like there's always a catch.
Right. Of course.
But AJ wanted to go. So I said, okay, fine. Screw it. We'll go. So we went, and then I felt like the jerk. I felt like I felt bad, because if I show you, let me show you this image right here real quick. Sorry. There he is. That's Captain Dan. And he promised me that he was going to show me the best sunset. And I said, okay, you know, and I'm being a jerk, be like, all right, we'll see. All right. You know, and then I asked him how much, right? And then let me keep going through all these. These are all my like kind of bunch. Oh, there it is. And then I asked him, okay, how much is it really going to cost? And then he actually sat down and said, all I want you to do is write down in this book that you'll remember, like a memory of this little boat trip, a memory and your names. And that's all he wanted.
Man, that's super rad. That's awesome.
I love it. So I took that picture. And then I already spoiler, you already saw the spoiler, but then he was right. He showed me the best sunset I ever saw. And I took that picture in front of his boat. But like I go back to like kind of, all right, I was noticing the sky and I wanted to take a picture of the river and the sky. Now that was a coincidence that I ended up like, or that was just like kind of a moment that I ended up taking with, you know, AJ, my friend.
Mm-hmm.
But you know, that's just me constantly thinking about the composition and me thinking about like the colors. And then, you know, stuff like that happens, you know, when you start seeing the world as in a photographic way.
Talk about happy accidents. I just love that Captain Dan's boat was that color too. It really just adds some weight to that.
Yeah. I'll never forget. This is one of my favorite story, one of my favorite experience. And then I always feel a little bad about it, because I was kind of like cold and like, no, go. Like, I don't want any. And yeah. I always thank AJ for like convincing me to go. And then after I realized that all I had to do was write about my experience in that notebook, like I was like, I don't know, my life changed there, because I just realized how, like, you know, when you travel long enough, you realize how small our actual problems are in life, you know?
Yeah.
So, but that's
heavy. That's heavy. That's, I like it.
That's out there. We digress.
That's all right.
To continue on like kind of the compositional, the stuff I want to talk about a little bit about the compositional elements that I use. I've already talked way too much about rule of thirds. So I use that one a lot. I also, believe it or not, I center the subject, even though we talked about rule of thirds. I center the subject, but only for specific photos. Usually for social media, centering the subject in like kind of Instagram and even Facebook, when it's a lot of like vertical photos, I just like to center the subject for the most part.
Mm-hmm.
But it's also like, I also like to break that compositional rule of like, okay, not enough headroom, a lot of headroom, mm-hmm. not in the rule of thirds, center it, just to capture the viewer's attention with those kind of awkward shock factor imagery. So right. Again, I'm using composition, I'm breaking the compositional rules to capture your attention, because not only it's a shocking photo, but it's also breaking all these compositional rules and it's like kind of confusing the viewer or making the viewer feel some sort of way, whether it's uncomfortable or weird. I don't know. So if I could show you some examples here. All right. So when I break the rules here. All right. So you see that image right there?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So this is an example of me breaking all of those like kind of compositional rules, right? Because I'm centering the subject. I'm lowering her. She's like not really in the center. Mm-hmm. But I'm using that, all that, because I'm able to break those rules just because I understand the actual rule. And the reason I'm breaking them is just because I want to create more of an emotion, more of I want to make you feel uncomfortable. You know, right. because if the rule of third, for example, or using, you know, kind of like the horizon as like kind of putting it in the third of the frame makes you feel calm and makes you feel like, okay, this is a good photo, then I need to break that rule and put you in the center and be like, okay, I'm not used to seeing that composition.
Yeah.
You know, and I don't like it. And then that's my goal, right? That's like my goal. And then that's kind of where I'm leading towards, like kind of this conversation is like kind of we again have control of the viewer's eyes and the viewer's feelings. And we do that with, you know, the understanding of composition.
Excellent.
So that's an example of that. Let me stop sharing that. All right. So other just to like kind of just kind of fast forward a couple things that I do. Let me set up a photo here now that I'm a little bit more organized. Here's a couple examples also of like kind of things that I've done. So, all right. So you got to understand, maybe this will be this is what I've learned also with my experience. I've learned also like kind of composition when it comes to lines. Lines could also bring emotions. I didn't know this until like I started experimenting with it. Like, it's very rare, but if you do it a lot, like you'll realize like people will comment on it or DM you about like, oh man, this made me feel a certain way. And I'm like, oh, look at that. And examples I got is like, you know, vertical lines. A lot of it, if you see a lot of vertical lines, for example, trees, or to be a little bit more dramatic, a prison cell. If you take images of like the prison cells, you know, that shows a lot of powerful, strong imagery.
Mm.
You know, so you could understanding that, okay. Let me show this like massive prison cell, like down the hallway. That shows a lot of dramatic and a lot of powerful imagery within that, because it's a lot of a lot of lines that are vertical. Same thing goes with trees. I also learned that horizontal horizontal lines are also like kind of, they show a lot of they show a lot of like calm and tranquility, and that's why with landscape photography, you know, they take advantage of that. They show a lot of like horizon with that. So
that's interesting. I never thought of it that way, but that makes total sense. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And then, you know, and there's no rule that says you can't, you gotta like separate those. People have combined that, right, with like mm-hmm. kind of like the power of a river, you know, using the horizon and using these trees, showing like how impressive that is, you know. So the more I looked into it, I'm like, okay, this makes sense to me, but it's always in the back of my mind when I'm shooting like either, you know, a lot of horizontal elements or vertical elements. You know, these are things I think about because of composition.
Right.
And I also pay attention to shapes, patterns, lines, shadows. So these are just kind of me just shotgunning a lot of things that I like kind of just like look for,
right?
And I think that's really important for people. And then the last thing I look for is texture. A lot of people forget about texture is never talked about when it comes to composition, and I understand why, but like you could add in so much when it comes to texture. And then mm-hmm. that means like, again, keeping the viewer's attention. So for example, a basketball player or an athlete, if they have like a lot of sweat mm-hmm. and if you put them if you use your composition, but then you add in the texture with their sweat, and you know, that even adds in a lot more to your composition.
Right.
And so a small example that I'll show you is it's a self-portrait, but
I've seen this one.
Right. So paint in the face, you know, it's not like it's not sweat in the face, but right, paint in the face is it shows that texture of, okay, I don't know. It could feel, you could make the viewer again feel like that feeling of like, oh, wipe that off, you know, or you could feel like you could have that viewer stay there a little bit longer because of just simply texture. If I did not have that paint there at all, you know, like the viewer probably would have watched this image for like half a second and kept moving on. But because I decided to add in texture and decided to add in, you know, white and a white background with paint, and then use the lighting, you know, to show the dryness of the texture. That's what I was thinking about in the background, you know, right, behind the scenes. So texture also could help with your final composition. The last thing is going to be angles and your lens choice. I think this is, you know, self-explanatory. Mm-hmm. You know, again, if you choose a low angle, you'll make the subject look like a superhero. If you choose a high angle, you make him look like, you know, a small person. You know, if you choose a wide lens, you could distort the image.
Right.
And if you choose a zoom lens, you could change the perspective, you know, compressing the image. Mm-hmm. But these are things that you need to know and to manipulate your composition and your final image. So that's the last thing that I kind of like talk about as far as technical goes.
Right.
And the composition, you know, your composition, everything relies on your composition, honestly, because it's you. This is the challenge that I love as a photographer. And the number one challenge, it's harder for us to tell a story within one image, right? Because video, and when it comes to movie, there's a beginning, middle, and end, and you get to see it unfold. You know, as a photographer, you got to be able to tell a story within one image. And that's why composition is such a powerful tool for you to master. Because you have to be able to tell a story within that one image. And then that's kind of what I think. That's always how I'm thinking. And the best image that I've created to actually tell a story is when the pandemic kind of like was hot and like everything was just like kind of shut down.
Right.
Okay, you see it?
Yes.
So, right. So again, right. How do you tell a story within the image? This is a whole bunch of compositional, like kind of elements that I've decided to like start using. Contrast of color, contrast of light. And then putting something we didn't talk about was balancing, right? That's a composition where you could balance, like if you have a strong element on the left or a strong subject on the left and a strong subject on the right, how do you balance that? You know, that's also composition. Framing, there's framing there with the female subject. Mm-hmm. And then there's also a story behind everything, right? This is another self-portrait, but this is me drinking alone during the pandemic.
Right.
So the reason I was able to tell the story was of all the compositional, you know, elements and all the composition that I've like kind of learned throughout the years. And all right, how can I, you know, create an image and tell a story behind it? So that's how strong an image can be when you understand composition. It sounds simple, but it's, I guess it is. It just, you just have to really understand composition, like really, really like dig in deep and understand that composition is a lot more than just leading lines and rule of thirds.
Yeah. When you really break it down like this, I mean, you definitely can understand what it is that makes us feel whatever when we look at an image like this. And this is obviously a very dramatic image. I've seen this one actually, I believe. And yeah, it tells a story. It's dramatic and it's relevant, you know, to what a lot of people probably felt over the last couple of years. So it's an awesome image. Yeah. And it's not one of those things where you can just, you know, point and shoot and hope for the best. You know, you have to understand these elements, like, which you obviously do by looking at this.
Yep. And then I'll go ahead and end my compositional rant with, you know, it takes time. It takes time. Again, I've been doing this since 2006.
Mm-hmm.
So it takes time, but like it's that process of learning and everything you've learned about it. Like I you got to train your eye. You got to learn how to see the world in a photographic way. You know, think right. like a camera and start noticing shape, lights, shadows, patterns. And then again, what we talked about before, fill the frame. You know, don't be afraid to zoom in with your feet. Control the background. You have so much control that you don't realize. Get rid of all the distractions as possible so you don't have to do it on post. And then again, remember that, you know, the more you learn about composition, the more you learn about controlling the viewer's eye. Mm-hmm. And that's important, especially in the world today. We're all scrolling. We scroll on Instagram, you know, constantly. But if you're able to like stop a viewer mm-hmm. with your imagery, with your composition, then you've succeeded. You know, absolutely. That's a success. Because we, you know, we've all done it. We just keep scrolling until one of us, you know, until a photograph like kind of just catches our attention or yeah. stops us from scrolling. And that all begins with composition.
You basically just described my Instagram experience. You know, a lot of people just scroll. Oh, that's awesome. Like, you know,
yeah. yeah, that's what it is. That's how it is now. So I always like to end these conversations and these like kind of like rants, like, hey, like we got to become, everyone now has a camera, right? Mm-hmm. So everyone now has a phone that can take pictures. And damn good pictures, because yeah. these phone cameras are amazing. Mm-hmm. So you got to make sure that you're not, don't be a picture taker, be an image creator. And then yeah. that's kind of like what I tell, you know, people and myself, all right, I'm not going to be out there taking pictures. I'm going to create an image.
Right.
And that's how I like to like, you know, finish my compositional talk.
It's funny because you've mentioned at least two or three topics I think that we could probably make separate like talks about or sessions about, to talk about, like, you know, A, obviously the combat photography one, B, mm-hmm. right there, you know, with what you just said about the smartphones and creating images instead of taking pictures. You know, those are all things you could completely do your own separate. We could talk for a long time about it.
Definitely.
Kind of to take us out toward the end here, now, I mentioned earlier that you use TikTok, and before we started recording here, you and I talked about this for a second. One of the ways that I noticed your work was behind the scenes stuff you showed. Like, so you showed the story behind the shot, how you chose this location, how you chose the angle, how you chose the elements that are involved in the picture. And you've really used TikTok to highlight those things. So maybe just give me a brief rundown of how that came together and how that started becoming a popular thing for you to do.
So, all right. Yeah. So when it comes to TikTok, social media, you know, Instagram, here's the thing. I started realizing when I was living in Hawaii that photographers are very secretive. Mm-hmm. But this was in like 2015. So photographers are very secretive. Like, hey, where'd you shoot that? Or how'd you shoot it? You know, and then they won't tell you, you know, it's right. like, ooh, right. So I'm like, all right, I got it. You know, me being a competitive person, you know, especially with the art of photography, you know, I was like, I'll find a damn place. You know, I'll figure it out. But that was also before TikTok. But I decided to be the opposite of that. You know, when someone asked me for something, I would, you know, obviously I understand. Let me take a step back. I understand why people do keep it a secret, mm-hmm. especially location. You know, we don't want to like kind of ruin a spot with, you know, littering or too much people. I get that.
Sure.
I get that. But I don't know. I just wish people could see how I'm one of the good guys, you know, like I could, you know, I'll be part of the team. So I decided to like, okay, let me, before I invite people or before I let people come with me or tell everyone, let me just talk to them, right? Let me get to know them. The whole point is that I learned quickly that I had no problem giving out my secrets, my location, the way I edit. I had no problem because I realized quickly that you and I, just talking to you and I, we could take the picture of the same subject at the same location, but you will never ever be able to edit like I can, and I will never ever be able to edit like you can. Right. You developed your own editing skills, and you could probably learn something from me just as much as I could learn something from you. But in the end, that is still a No Way Jose photo because I've developed a style that took me like over a decade to do.
Right. Great point.
So that's the only reason I don't care about like, okay, yeah, you could take that same picture, the same subject, the same pose, but like, that's it. Like you'll have to develop your own style. I mean, shit, you could have my own preset if you want, but in the end, like it's still like you, I don't know. In the end, like I had no problem with that.
Mm-hmm.
So that kind of magnified a little bit. And I'm like, you know what, let me take a step further and just start documenting, you know, put more work to me, more work for me, and start documenting every step I take for an image, you know. So I would like put a camera over my shoulder and how I Google map, especially when I was living in Hawaii or even in Maryland. I've moved to Maryland and close to the DC area. I would like Google map the coast.
Mm-hmm.
And then I would look for a foreground within Google Maps. I'm like, okay, look at that. There's like some sort of like logs or sticks that are popping out of from the sand. How long does it take me from get there? But I'm documenting this. And mm-hmm. then I document me Googling it. And then I document myself, like just, you know, selfie style, vlog style, driving there. And then I document me taking the photo. I'm going to pull up the photo real quick. Right. Mm-hmm. So, all right. So there it is. And then, all right. So I see it. And then there's a bunch of those logs or whatever that is. There's a bunch of them in a row, like next to each other. So I'm walking around and the sun's coming up because I drive, you know, right, trying to beat the sun. You know, I'm there before the sun rises. And this is not Photoshop. There was, I found a bird just chilling there. And I'm like, this is the spot. And a funny story is that like there was a guy taking a photo of that. And I'm like, and then this is where, like, again, what I talked about in the beginning, you sometimes have to have a little bit of that thick skin, you know, you can't be shy.
Mm-hmm.
And I asked, I'm gonna take a picture next to you, man. like I'm gonna be right next to you. And then he's like, oh, I already took the photo, you know, I'm good. And I left. I'm like, all right, cool. All right. And but again, like I documented that whole process. And this is an example of the 52-week photo challenge. So I was already documenting the behind the scenes. Mm-hmm. But before that image, I started realizing that like a lot of people were learning so much of just me not even saying a word, but just me seeing of them just seeing the process.
Right.
So then they would share it and then they would share it. And that brought a lot of attention again to my TikTok. And I got to say, it was also probably maybe the way I edited it. It was kind of fast paced. It was like kind of, it was vertical, fast paced.
That good flow.
Yeah. And then that also is kind of the stuff I've learned also in the past in the military, like how to document, you know, just fast paced, just trying to keep your attention. No, really like build, just bam, 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 bam. And then this is how I got it. So that brought a lot of attention to TikTok. And then what made my TikTok, I guess, explode was the fact that they realized that every week I was doing a different theme.
Mm-hmm.
And then they would see me either struggle, fail, or succeed in that theme, whatever theme it was, you know, whether it's landscape, because I sucked at art. If you looked at if you look back at my TikTok, I was so mad and I was sucked at architecture photography. I didn't know how to do it. I didn't know what to look for. And I was like sweating, you know, out in DC, you know, trying to figure that part out. But people appreciated that. Like the image wasn't that great, but the behind the scenes of me being human and noticing that like, okay, he did not really succeed very well on that was appreciated. You know, it's weird.
I get it.
Yeah. So that's how I tackled TikTok and social media, was kind of just being a real photographer and sharing my secrets and showing everything, the whole process on camera.
Nice. I think we can cut it out from here. Let's give you a chance to give a plug on for your social and all that stuff. And I'll post some links up too at the end of the video. But maybe just talk about what you're doing and what you're looking to do project-wise or maybe just content-wise.
All right. So the main thing I want to plug is, so I've done this on purpose, but I've kept my military career and my photography in the military, mm-hmm. I'm separate from No Way Jose Photography.
Right.
And I did that on purpose because I wanted to prove not only to myself, but to, like, I guess the world, is that, like, I want you to follow me for No Way Jose Photography. I don't want you to follow me because I'm in the military and you want to support mm-hmm. me, you know, which is something I love, but I want you to follow No Way Jose Photography. That's like the brand I wanted to create.
Right.
But this is now that the, like, kind of, I'm in a situation now where, like, I am in Germany and I am doing a lot of military stuff. This is a situation where now I can, like, kind of explain of what it is that I do outside of No Way Jose Photography. Mm-hmm. So the one thing I want to plug is that I actually made a short documentary film of combat photography and imagery that I've done. I had a GoPro on me, and then I was in a, what they call an air assault exercise, where you get in a helicopter and you go down and you attack. Mm-hmm. And the GoPro is on me, and I have a camera, and I'm documenting that whole exercise. So that documentary will be posted like fairly quick. It'll be like next week. Mm-hmm. So next week, the specific date, I'm not too sure just yet. Probably, I don't know, I'm thinking Monday, but it could also be Friday. So I'm awesome. Hoping to get it done by Monday. And then that's the only thing I want to plug.
I'm looking forward to that because I've seen a few clips in the last day or two. So
yeah.
Definitely looking excited about that. Cool. I will post some links up to your social. I always look forward to seeing your work, whether it be some BTS videos or the actual works themselves.
Nice.
So I thank you again for joining me, my friend.
Of course. Thank you for having me. Honestly, this was fun.